Chile, a country of rough mountains, expansive highland plains and thousands of kilometers of seacoast, but also volcanoes and earthquakes. On the map, you see active volcanoes shown with the corresponding symbols, and earthquakes are indicated by circles. The bigger, the greater the magnitude. The strongest earthquake worldwide ever recorded by seismometers also occurred here in Chile. It took place on May 22, 1960 and had a magnitude of 9.5. Chile is a country that is highly vulnerable to earthquakes. Hello and welcome. How can we use the records of earthquakes to estimate future seismic hazards? And how likely are people and material assets to be in danger because of them? The answer to this is indicated by likelihood, that means probabilistically. This has the advantage of including a large number of possible scenarios and not just one single variant. First of all, I will give you a short introduction to seismic hazard analysis. It forms the basis for all risk assessments and is of great importance for authorities and affected branches of industry. But what exactly is seismic risk? Let me explain to you the relationship between seismic hazard and risk using a brief example. Santiago de Chile, the capital of Chile. You have already seen on the map that strong earthquakes occur nearby. This means that the hazard level is high. For risk, two other things are also important. Firstly, the vulnerability of the city. Secondly, the exposure, which refers to the asset values in the area of effect of the event. Santiago is highly vulnerable. For one, a lot of people live here in a small space. Secondly, a great deal of assets are locked in buildings and infrastructure. Risk is calculated as hazard times vulnerability times exposure. Santiago has a high seismic risk, as opposed to the areas of Chile which are not inhabited or cultivated. Although they have a high seismic hazard level, they have a low vulnerability and hence a smaller seismic risk. Let me now show you how to calculate the seismic hazard of a particular location. The procedure consists of four steps. Firstly, the description of the seismic sources. Here, all possible quake locations are included, which may have an effect at the location being investigated. Secondly, the temporal and spatial distribution of earthquakes. Here, the statistical Gutenberg-Richter distribution is typically used. It describes for a particular geographical zone the average frequency of quakes of various magnitudes. The third point relates to the resulting ground motion as a consequence of the earthquake. Here, ground motion prediction equations are used. They predict how strongly the Earth's surface will be still moving as the distance from the earthquake increases. Fourthly and finally, all this information is summarized in order to calculate the occurrence probability of the effects of earthquakes. This results in predictions such as the probability of ground acceleration of 5 meters per second squared within the next 50 years is 10%. Every hazard assessment consists of these four steps. I had the earthquake engineer and science slammer Andreas Schäfer illustrate this using Chile as an example. He works at the company Risk Layer in Karlsruhe. It is a spin-off of the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology and compiles risk studies on the hazard of natural catastrophes.
Hi, and welcome to Risk Layer.
Hi.
Let's sit down.
Thanks. Andreas, your company Risk Layer compiles risk assessments for clients around the world. Today, you have an example for us from Chile. Why is Chile such an interesting country?
There are several reasons for that. For one, it is one of the countries in the world most vulnerable to earthquakes. Secondly, due to the high mountains that begin relatively close to the coast, many cities are located directly on the coast where most earthquakes also take place. Furthermore, Chile has a lot of highly vulnerable industries, for example wine growing, which has also been hit hard by earthquakes several times over the past few years.
Wine growing is threatened by earthquakes?
Definitely. For example, during storage. This means when ground motion might cause wine bottles to fall off of shelves. Another example are wrapped tanks causing the wine to already be damaged during production. And it's not only the wine industry that is highly threatened, but also tourism. In Chile, perhaps not that much, but we all can remember the Sumatra tsunami of 2004 and other events where tourist locations and popular travel destinations were hit hard by catastrophes.
How serious is the earthquake hazard in Chile? And how probable are damage-relevant earthquakes? To answer this, let's return to our four-point formula. The first step was the distribution of the earthquakes. Andreas, how are the earthquakes in Chile distributed?
First of all, we need to know that there's a large subduction zone in Chile. This means that one plate dips under the other here. So primarily shallow and very powerful earthquakes occur along the entire coastline. When we look into the country's interior, this plate subducts deeper, and at least the major quakes take place at a greater depth. Smaller quakes still take place at the surface due to the structure of the mountains. These unique circumstances, a number of shallow quakes in the mountains, stronger ones in greater depth, and the really major ones along the coastline, can be summarized using what we call seismotectonic zones. This means Chile can be discretized into smaller regions with specific earthquake characteristics.
Let's pick one zone as an example and move on to the next step of the hazard analysis. How are the quakes distributed over time in central Chile?
If we, for example, pick earthquakes of magnitude 4, they take place once every few days, which is relatively often. But earthquakes of magnitude 8 occur relatively seldom. On average, such events take place every 25 years and may cause extensive damage, in some cases also tsunamis. But even though we have estimated an average return period, this does not mean that events will occur regularly. In fact, they are often clustered over time. There are recurrent phases during which these quakes occur more frequently. This means that it's certainly possible that there may be only 5 to 10 years between two magnitude 8 quakes, while during other phases 20, 30, 40 or even 50 years may pass without such an earthquake. But overall, we estimate an average of around 25 years.
This means that the people there regularly experience earthquakes, as strong quakes can be felt over hundreds of kilometers. Damages, on the other hand, occur at smaller distances. That brings us to the third point of the hazard analysis, the ground motion as a consequence of the quake.
In order to calculate this, we can use ground motion prediction equations, or short GMPE. They are based on a large quantity of seismological measurement data, which use the actual ground motion from historical quakes from the past decades in order to estimate this as a single function. A large number of them were developed, and we have here as an example the function from Youngs and colleagues from the year 1979. Here we see ground motion on the y-axis and on the x-axis the distance in kilometers. And it's immediately visible that the larger movements occur near to the event. Then the curve falls with an increasing distance, for example, from 10 to 100 kilometers by a factor of 10. So these values around 0.1 to 0.05 meters per square second can be felt, but do not result in damages. It's important that ground movement does not only depend on the distance and the general strength of the quake, but also on local effects, such as the kind of ground at the location. Is it soft ground, sand, or is it hard rock? Depending on this, it's more strongly or weakly amplified, and we also have a different damage pattern depending on the local geological structure.
This means that we now know approximately how often which magnitudes occur in central Chile, and we are aware of the impact of the ground motion. We can now summarize all this in the calculation of the occurrence probability of an earthquake.
Right, this then gives a hazard curve for a particular location. Let's take the city Santiago de Chile. We can develop this curve here. On the y-axis we have the ground acceleration and on the x-axis the occurrence probability. And this probability is calculated with the assumption that the earthquakes occur randomly with a Poisson distribution. And here we can also see at a glance that very small earthquakes occur very frequently. This means we see the minimal ground motion they cause. And significantly rare are, of course, the major ground motions of strong quakes.
Such curves are then calculated nationwide for the whole of Chile and presented in form of a map. And you have brought us such a map today.
Yes, right. For such a map, you need to pick a certain probability, for example, a 10% probability in 50 years. Others commonly used are 5 or 1%. So here we have 10% as an example. And we can see that the hazard level increases from the gray zones, where earthquakes are technically not to be expected, up to the red ones, which indicate the highest level. We can also clearly see that the greatest hazard is, of course, along the coast where subduction takes place. And it decreases the more you move away from the coast. And at certain locations, you can sometimes also recognize individual local hazard clusters. This can be due to a volcano or due to a local fault line. This means that such a map is always a combination of all hazard potentials which could occur in the area.
To now calculate the risk, we can combine this hazard map with vulnerability and exposure. For example, what is the exposure for wine growing in Chile now?
To do this, we can simply have a closer look at the exposure of wine growing worldwide. For this purpose, we can use various parameters. To make it easier to compare, we have indicated the share of wine industry of each individual country. The color of the map indicates the percentage of the gross domestic product of each country. Here we can see that regions where we usually get our wine, whether it's Italy, France, Spain, but also the US, have a moderate to high share of 1 to 2%. Chile is also strongly represented here. This means that Chile is indeed one of the most active countries in the world with regard to exposure and, above all, the economic power which is dependent on the wine industry.
We see that there are a lot of components that ultimately go into calculating seismic risk. What exactly do your clients require this information for?
For many things. For one, the information alone on how great the risk actually is. How much damage can an individual wine grower or wine growing group expect in a year due to natural catastrophes such as earthquakes? And how they can deal with these damages? Can they store their bottles better? Should they perhaps reinforce the building? Or would it be prudent to take out an insurance policy? On the other hand, insurance companies are, of course, also interested. Because having the correct information on the risks, they can also offer the right products for their clients. That means that they are also not so expensive that nobody can afford them, but also not so cheap that they cannot cover the costs when a catastrophe occurs.
Andreas, this trip to Chile was extremely informative. Thank you. What is your next project?
My next project is indirectly related to my doctoral thesis, where I attempt to calculate tsunami risks worldwide. And in this specific project, the aim is to calculate the risk for beaches, or to find out how much a beach is in fact worth for tourism. What are the associated hazards? And perhaps how endangered is your favorite beach the next time you go on a vacation?
I wish you the best of success with that.
Thank you.
Today you learned how seismic hazards can be estimated probabilistically. To do so, we need information on the location of the quake, the frequency, and the effects on ground motion. This then gives us a hazard curve. Finally, we combine that with the vulnerability and the exposure of various assets or structure to obtain the risk of financial losses or collapsing buildings. In Chile and worldwide, there are many such hazards due to natural catastrophes. If we are able to correctly estimate them, we can better prepare for their arrival.